You know, I grew up in the scientific world of, you know, the hierarchy of evidence. So you've got epidemiological evidence, case control studies, but really the thing that you need to have to be able to look a patient in the face and say, this is going to help you, is a randomized controlled trial. And those type of trials take a long time. They take a long time. And the problem in this is that the system that we've set up of randomized controlled trials, applications to the FDA, these are great for diseases and conditions that are with us chronically and that move slowly, but they're not adequately designed to really help the majority of people in a worldwide pandemic, because people are dying very, very quickly and you want to come up with answers very, very fast, and these things take time. So that's one thing that I learned very, very quickly, is that if you want to try to save lives, and you know, all of us are look at this from a different point of view. I guess I'm coming from the point of view of, yeah, I understand the ivory towers. I understand the people at the FDA. I understand the people that want to, the people are relying on them to say, here's something that we've tested that looks good and it works. But on the other hand, I'm working in the trenches too. So I'm looking family members in the face and they're looking at me and it's like, what can I do for our loved one? What is going to work? And what we have to do is marry those two concepts together and come up with things, I believe, that may have plausibility to work, but if we're going to institute something, if we're going to do something, it's got to have very, very low risk. And so what you've seen is you've seen a wide variety of things now that have gone through the FDA that probably never would have been approved under normal situation. But because of the pandemic and the flexibility that we need to have, we need to move quickly, because as things get out of hand, more and more people are dying. So for instance, convalescent plasma was approved using emergency use authorization through the FDA. There was no controls in that study. So that's just an example of the type of things that we're doing. We're moving quickly here. We're in a pandemic. And we have to be creative, and we have to be understanding that this is not business as usual. But if you find any kind of pharmacological intervention, be it hydroxychloroquine, be it ivermectin, and we can talk about those things have to be scaled so rapidly and to such high degree that as soon as you say this medication is efficacious, you can't find it in the pharmacy. It's gone. And so what this has done as an individual has really looked at plausible, biochemically plausible, rational, efficacious remedies that are not a cure-all, they're to fix you or protect you 100%, but may in a population type of setting swing things enough so that we can deaden the blow of the pandemic.
And are you talking in a sense about lifestyle factors, things that
oh yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So lifestyle factors, but not just lifestyle factors, because what are you going to do with somebody who has not been practicing the proper lifestyle and now they get COVID-19? What do they do? It's too late for them to institute lifestyle changes that are really long lasting. But what do they do? And I think there is a science behind some of the things that we can do. And it's an all of the above type of thing. It's not just any one thing that's going to help. It's like, for instance, when you go to the operating room, right, we want to prevent infections. And so we don't think that just the doctor or the surgeon wearing the mask is going to solve everything. We also have a negative pressure or a positive pressure operating room, and we make sure that we use betadine or chloroprep on the incision. We're doing multiple things because nothing particularly by itself is going to be effective. And so some of the stuff we've been talking about today, like hydrotherapy, or we'll talk about vitamin D, none of those things by themselves is going to, you know, wipe out the pandemic. We have to do all of the other things that we know work. Think again about the fact that 80% of all symptomatic COVID-19 patients, 80% never need to go to the hospital. Why? Because their innate immune system does the job. It takes care of the virus. 20% end up going to the hospital. If we could somehow increase that 80% to 85%, 90%, that would have a huge impact on the number of people that are seeking medical attention right now.